Thank you so much for tuning in tonight. I'm going to talk about the Muskrat Falls project this evening. I'm going to talk about how it came into existence, how it's going to make our rates go up, how it's going to saddle our province with a staggering amount of debt, and how I've been trying to process all of that and remain hopeful throughout it. However, I just want to acknowledge right off the top that whatever negative impacts there are to me and to other ratepayers in the province, they really do pale in comparison to the impacts of this project on the Indigenous people of Labrador through the flooding of the Lake Melville Reservoir and the risk of methyl mercury contamination of their traditional food system. I will talk about that later. So this story has triggered a lot of anger and anxiety and a deep sense of insecurity in me over a period of years. It came to a head during the early days of the pandemic with the economic shutdown, the huge drop in the price of oil, and the near bankruptcy of the Newfoundland and Labrador government, when our premier wrote to Trudeau to tell him we were broke and only a few weeks away from not being able to make payroll. At that point, the looming specter of the Muskrat Falls project coming on stream and the projected doubling of our electricity rates really just hit me with this destabilizing sense of far too much being completely out of my control, and I had to try and understand what the hell was going on. So I started working on this piece and taking political science courses through Mun Distance and talking to a really great therapist. And so you may be the judge of whether that was a productive endeavor or not. So I take a lot of hot baths during the winter, and sometimes I use way too much hot water. And over the last couple of years, I noticed that sometimes when I'm in the bath, I tend to burrow down this rabbit hole of worry about electricity rates going up and all the uncertainty we're faced with. And I'm wondering what the cost of hot water will be when Muskrat Falls finally comes on stream. And presumably, the cost of food rises as a result. How will our government respond? Will there be a bailout from Ottawa? If so, what strings will be attached? What comforts will we have to forgo? Perhaps I'll be dreaming of hot baths instead of taking them. Our government's dealings around Muskrat Falls have left us dangerously vulnerable as a people. It reflects the kind of political culture we have and the way decisions are made. Personally, I think there are so many great things about living here, and I think there's a lot that our government does well. But tonight I'm going to focus on the whole Muskrat Falls debacle, because I feel that it has threatened the good life that I have built here and undermined my personal sense of security and stability that I've worked very hard to cultivate. I've taken it personally, and maybe that's not a good thing, except it really is personal. I've been asking myself, what is my responsibility as a citizen of our beloved province? I read the executive summary of Muskrat Falls, a misguided project, Commission of Inquiry report by Judge Richard LeBlanc when it came out a couple of weeks before the pandemic hit and our attention was quickly diverted away from it. That report rather made my head explode. The sense of entitlement and sheer disregard for the long-term welfare of the people of the province from those named in that report is astounding to me. And it has created this kind of cognitive dissonance in my brain, because it seems like everyone involved in the management of the project thought that they were doing what was best for the province, and yet despite those good intentions, they have brought us to this point of unprecedented economic precarity. And I'm nervous about how our government is going to deal with that. So this is an incredibly complex story, and I have to try and wrestle it down to something semi-coherent that will last under an hour, and so I have to leave out many salient details. And hopefully not leave you feeling depressed and beaten down. A couple of things I should mention. The government of Newfoundland and Labrador will often be referred to as the GNL, or sometimes Big Daddy GNL. The Lower Churchill Project refers to the whole project, of which the dam at Muskrat Falls is only one part, but I will use those terms interchangeably. The Lower Churchill Project, or the LCP, has been a dream of our dear leaders for a very long time. From Joey, all the way down to Danny, who passed it off to Kathy, who passed it off to Tom, then Paul, then Dwight, and now it's passed to Dr. Andrew. When the project was sanctioned in 2012 by the GNL, the projected cost was stated at $6.2 billion plus interest. Presently, 4 years behind schedule and at a cost overrun exceeding 50%, the projected cost is somewhere between $13 and $14 billion. The project is composed of four parts. One, a dam, an 824 megawatt hydroelectric plant situated at Muskrat Falls on the Lower Churchill River in Labrador, traditional territory of the Innu Nation. Two, a high voltage direct current transmission line between Muskrat Falls and Soldiers Pond on the island of Newfoundland, otherwise known as the Labrador Island Link. Three, a high voltage alternating current transmission line between Muskrat Falls and the generating plant at Churchill Falls, called the Labrador Transmission Assets. And four, in conjunction with this project, a Nova Scotia-owned company, the parent company of Nova Scotia Power, built a high voltage transmission line between the island of Newfoundland and Nova Scotia, called the Maritime Island Link, or the MIL. This is a massive project, a political project, an unnecessary project. Danny's project. Hey! It has created a massive debt which must be paid by us. We are responsible for repaying the cost of this project through our electricity rates, and so face the doubling of those rates when the project finally comes online. There are talks with Ottawa, but no firm agreement yet on a rate mitigation plan and debt management. So I must skip over our province's truly fascinating history of frustrated nationhood. The, at times, contentious treatment from Ottawa when it comes to control of our resources within the terms of union. Our history of long periods of one-party dominance. Our pathological repetition of bad project deals. Our hope for a savior. Our reliance on father figures. And our cultural propensity for elevating them to deity status and rewarding their nationalistic framing of the narrative of themselves as defending NL's interests as David to Ottawa's Goliath, or Quebec's Goliath in this case. Our, at times, toxic partisan politics and the public's growing apathy with said politics and the fallout from all of that which has brought me standing to the stage tonight. There are serious journalists in this province who did the hard and underappreciated work of warning how the project would play out. and asking the hard questions of those who hold power. Here's little Jeff Meeker, who covered the project and wrote a deadly series of editorials in the Telegram predicting how it would play out. Here's Uncle Gnarly, the blogger. Here's another blogger, Ed Hollett. Me, me, me. Here's Ron Penny and David Vardy of the Concerned Citizens Coalition.
Hey!
So many sage voices offering warnings to government. Here's two of the Labrador land protectors, little Marjorie Flowers and little Beatrice Hunter, who protested the project and went to jail for it. Here's little Lorraine Michael, one of the most sensible voices ever to grace our House of Assembly, who asked hard questions that no one in government wanted to answer. There were concerned citizens groups who wanted to stop the train, but the train didn't stop because government didn't want to listen to them. And under the Danny Williams government, who initiated this project, anyone who questioned the project was labeled as unpatriotic and against the province.
What? That's not true.
Yes, it is true, Danny. It is too true. That's not my opinion. That's a fact. It's on the record. And there are fewer and fewer journalists doing essential investigative work, asking the hard questions of those who hold power and interpreting it for the public.
Come on. Okay. How's about a kitchen to fish? She brings them home to Lizer. Hey, what? Bag tag.
Judge me. In 2003, when the Williams government came to power, we were in rough shape with a record deficit. Danny warned we would have to cut 4,000 public sector jobs. A new Atlantic Accord deal was a critical first step in us regaining stability, and Danny knew how to negotiate. What a star power move! He walked out of the first minister's meeting in Ottawa, turning his back on the Paul Martin Liberal government. He came home and soon after ordered all provincial buildings to lower the Canadian flag, and he held to it for 3 weeks.
You little firecracker, Danny, you were a master political theater, little man.
Finally, in 2005, the Atlantic Accord deal was amended to ensure that we retained 100% of revenue from the offshore. It was a remarkable achievement. Oh, we had Danny fever. Remember that? Remember how we believed a success in business would lead to success for the whole province?
Remember how he could make us laugh with his antics on This Hour Has 22 Minutes? Yay, it was cool!
He doubled the budget of the Newfoundland and Labrador Arts Council, and I voted PC for the first time in my life. The Danny Williams government was so good to us! Remember the heady days after the signing of the Atlantic Accord? Remember the ABC, the Anything But Harper campaign?
You little hothead! It was kind of appalling to watch, but also just like a teeny bit awesome. You were like, STFU, Harper, Danny wants his money.
You were a gifted populist leader, little man, and you knew how to grab the headlines, I'll give you that. The ABC campaign kind of backfired, didn't it? Because in 2009, when Harper got elected, he changed the equalization formula, which reduced NL's bottom line by $1.6 billion. So maybe in the end, it wasn't such a successful play.
During Danny's second term, we had a wild party from 2007 to 2010, paid for by our record oil revenues. You want a line, little man?
No, Danny don't do coke.
Good for you, little man. During that time, public spending increased by more than 30%. Danny's government slashed taxes. Between 2006 and 2010, personal income tax rates were cut by more than 25%. Woohoo! What a party! We didn't feel the hangover for several years later. The big party didn't immediately lead to deficits because of Danny's deal, which kept us receiving equalization payments even after we became a half province. Hey, high five, little man. Hey, whoa. But when the Atlantic Accord agreement expired in 2012, Danny had left and we were screwed. The equalization payments disappeared and the GNL faced huge deficits, even with oil at over $100 a barrel. By 2013, the Department of Finance estimated that Danny's tax cuts were costing us over $750 million a year in lost revenue. Without the Muskrat Falls debt, our deficit is now around $2 billion a year. Our province loses around $20 million for every $1 drop in the price of Brent crude oil. Such is a roller coaster of a resource-based economy. That was a wild party, man. Wow. Why did it have to end with this project, though, Danny? Burr, 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 burr. Who is it? Burr, burr, burr. Why, someone has a question. Why, it's Ace Editorialist, Little Jeff Meeker, for the Telegram. Burr, 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 burr. What is it, Little Jeff? Burr, 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 burr. That's a good question. I'll ask him. Burr, burr. Okay, Danny? Little Jeff wants to know why there was never a thorough or serious examination of the possible alternatives to the Muskrat Falls project.
What? What the hell kind of question is that? You tell him. It's a damn good project, and anyone who doesn't think so doesn't belong here.
He says it's a really good project, Little Jeff.
You tell him. That report is a fabrication and an assassination of my good character. Rawr!
I think we'll just give him a moment.
The project was proposed to be the least cost option to meet projected provincial energy demands. With a declining population, one might question whether those projections were at all based in reality. The fact is, there was sufficient generating capacity in the province already. The issue was the surge in demand during peak times of the day, like at morning and at supper time. And it was suggested that that issue could have been dealt with cheaply and sustainably by introducing incentives to consumers to cut down consumption during those peak times to spread out demand. A public awareness campaign could have helped. According to the report, alternative sources of electricity were not fully explored and were discarded for unjustifiable means. They would include adding to our already existing island hydro plants, retrofitting the thermal coal-powered generating plant at Holyrood, and using natural gas off the Grand Banks to power that to secure supply for NL alone. And wind! There was also the option of negotiating with Hydro-Québec around supplying us power at reasonable rates and us taking the time until 2041 to prepare for the renegotiation of the Churchill Falls contract. But it seems like our government's deep resentment of Quebec because of the Churchill Falls deal blinded them to fully exploring this possibility. The thing is, and this is important, little Jeff. Yep. This is a direct quote from the report, which encapsulates beautifully the insanity of the approach to the Muskrat Falls project in a nutshell. The decision to pursue the Lower Churchill project ought to have been the conclusion of a rigorous analysis. Instead, a rigorous analysis was not performed because of the decision to pursue the Lower Churchill project. Danny was going to have his project.
Danny's the man!
A crown agency, Nelcor, was created by the GNL to build the project. It was created to separate the activities of NL Hydro from the Lower Churchill project. Whereas the activities of NL Hydro are subject to oversight from the Public Utilities Board, our government created Nelcor to ensure it had no oversight from the Public Utilities Board so that it could pursue unregulated activities on the Lower Churchill project. Now, the Public Utilities Board, or the PUB, is an independent, quasi-judicial regulatory body responsible for a whole bunch of boring shit to do with oil, electricity rates, and cars, stuff that impacts our lives and our ability to function within the province. Its main responsibility is the regulation of the electric utilities in the province to ensure that the rates charged are just and reasonable, and that the service provided is safe and reliable. So the fact that Nelcor was created to build a giant hydroelectric project on the Lower Churchill River in Labrador and not be subject to oversight from the PUB raises a big... And so, in 2008, Big Daddy GNL, after much romancing of Mama Ratepayer, finally got his way.
Muskrat, muskrat, candlelight, doing the town and doing it right in the evening. It's pretty pleasing. Muskrat Susie, muskrat Sam, do the jitterbug out in Muskrat Land and shimmy. Sam is so skinny. Okay. And he whirl and he twirl and he tangle, singing and jangin' a jangle. Float like the heavens above. Looks like muskrat love.
Me. Oh, slow down. Oh, okay, baby.
I'm sorry. That was probably more than a little bit inappropriate. The thing is, I really don't know what kind of love story this is. I mean, did Mama Ratepayer really know what she was consenting to? I don't think so. And so, 9 months later, you know what happens. Ed Martin, former CEO of NL Hydro, was named CEO of Nalcor, keeping it in the family. The fact that he had no mega project experience, no experience in construction management or hydroelectric or transmission line projects did not seem to be a problem. In fact, according to the inquiry report, all of the core members of the project management team came from the oil and gas sector, and only one had any direct experience with hydro generation or transmission projects. This did not seem to be problematic for the GNL, because the GNL had faith in Nalcor. On November 18th, 2010, Danny signed a deal between Newfoundland and Labrador and Nova Scotia to develop the Lower Churchill project, and then a couple of weeks later announced he was quitting his job as premier. Here he goes, to retire into the sunset of Galway, to pass the project off to little Kathy. Yay! Kathy Dunderdale succeeded him. She was committed to building Muskrat Falls, and in the 2011 election, her party won a majority. And I was so happy to see a woman in the premier's office. Yay, little Kathy! Nalcor would construct all three parts for around $5 billion. Nova Scotia would build the Maritime Island Link for $1.2 billion, or 20% of the cost of the entire project. And in return, this would entitle them to 20% of Muskrat Falls energy. This became known as the 20 for 20 principle, and it makes sense. However, Nova Scotia agreed to pay 20% of the cost of construction when it was estimated at $5 billion, not when it ballooned to $10 billion. So Nova Scotia actually gets 20% ownership for only 12% of the cost. The agreement gives Nova Scotia Power first call on any excess power and protects Nova Scotia ratepayers from power rate shocks resulting from Muskrat Falls cost overruns. Newfoundland and Labrador ratepayers have no such protection. What's that, little Jeff? Oh, yeah, good point. You should tell them. Yeah, yeah. Little Jeff says,
there was absolutely no logic in building the subsea line and giving away power to Nova Scotia, because the power we are transmitting is costing us far more to produce than we can sell it for. It's a loss. So what was the point of the whole exercise?
Thank you, little Jeff. You rest. I can take it from here. I'm feeling like our long-term well-being was not represented at the table in the boardrooms during this process. Why, you guys? Why did you think this was a good idea for the province? I mean, it's so confusing to me because it's like you all thought you were doing what was best. I mean, why wouldn't you? You love this place as much as I do, right, guys?
Hey, yeah! Danny loves it. Kathy loves it. Dwight Ball loves it, too. Well, none of you love it more than Joey Smallwood, the father of Confederation.
Oh, shut up, Joey! You had 23 years to say it. If you didn't say it then, you don't get to say it now.
Right away, there were problems with young Nalcor. His daddy was absent, and so he didn't learn to respect authority, and he just wanted to do things his own way. He was secretive. According to the report, Big Daddy GNL did not effectively oversee Nalcor, and Nalcor exploited this trust by frequently concealing crucial information that, had it been revealed to the government and to the people, likely would have stopped it from going ahead. Judge LeBlanc found that Ed Martin and the project management team at Nalcor frequently took unprincipled steps to ensure project sanction, and that even when advised by an outside consulting firm that its schedule was completely unrealistic, Nalcor refused to revise it, and our government accepted that. Why? There were three decision gates that had to be passed in order for sanction of the project to happen. And at each stage, Nalcor knowingly lowballed the cost of the project under the influence, in the judge's words, of strategic misrepresentation, optimism bias, and political bias, which means they exaggerated benefits and understated costs, and they did this on purpose. So the decision to go ahead and spend billions and billions of our money was based on false information, which our government accepted at face value. Ed Martin, as CEO of Nalcor, failed to communicate the full cost of the project to the GNL. And when the GNL fired him in 2016, knowing what we know now, he was awarded a $6 million severance package. A word about the federal loan guarantee and Ottawa's responsibility in enabling our government to undertake a project that was unnecessary and ill-advised. The Harper government guaranteed to backstop the project with a loan guarantee, initially $5 billion, now increased to $7.9 billion. They made the guarantee contingent upon us giving Nova Scotia a sweet, sweet deal. And because of that federal guarantee, CIBC loaned our government the billions it needed for Muskrat, despite the ample signs that it was not a good idea to do that, that this was a bad project our government was not in a position to execute successfully. That loan guarantee was like a big coil of rope with which to hang ourselves. So Premier Dunderdale got her loan guarantee. She had worked hard all her cabinet years on the planning process for the project. She carried Danny's dream on and was determined the project would be built. So sure, in fact, that even when, in May 2011, the Departments of Finance and Natural Resources prepared a document, one that recommended hiring an independent consultant, one that would investigate Nalcor's analysis and due diligence because it was suspect, in a star power move, perhaps learned from her mentor, she rejected it outright without even referring the document to Cabinet. Why would you do that, little Kathy? Was it because you'd worked so hard on that project, that to admit it might have faults would be to admit your own fallibility, I wonder? No doubt you love your province as I do, Maid, but this project had so many warning signs, and yet you just pushed ahead anyway. I'm sorry, but it doesn't reflect well on your government. Sometimes, little Kathy, it just sucks to be the queen. By late 2013, all the ducks were lined up to close the deal and build the project. Kathy resigned in 2014 after her PC government sanctioned the project to the tune of $6.2 billion. So, without a major mitigation plan, this project will cause our electricity rates to double. Will eat up so much tax revenue that could have been used to benefit the people. It will impact us all for generations. Most of all, though, it has a profound effect on the Indigenous people of Labrador who rely on traditional food sources in and around the Lake Melville Reservoir. That's the huge area below the Muskrat Falls Dam, which has since been flooded. This part of the story is really painful. Lake Melville is downstream from Muskrat Falls Dam. It was this subarctic, brackish estuary from which both Indigenous and settler populations harvested much of their traditional foods. These foods are highly nutritious and, for those with access, cheap to harvest. The cost of food in grocery stores in Labrador is far more expensive compared to the island, like 2 to 4 times as much. The Lake Melville Reservoir was not included in an environmental assessment conducted by Nalcor because Nalcor predicted the dam would have no impact on the reservoir. In 2014, the Nanatsiavut government commissioned a Harvard-led study on the impacts of methylmercury from the Muskrat Falls Dam. According to that study, there was no basis at all for Nalcor to draw that conclusion. Data from other projects shows that very often the downstream impacts are serious. When you dam a river, the mercury levels in fish increase. Methylmercury is a neurotoxin the WHO ranks among the top 10 chemicals of public health concern, and it is known that with the flooding of the reservoir below the dam, without removing all the vegetation first, methylmercury levels will begin to rise and will contaminate the food chain. The Harvard study found that consuming foods around the reservoir after flooding could lead to higher risk of heart disease, risk to fetus neurodevelopment, reduction of IQs in the next generation, and could open up a whole bunch of unknown risk factors. In 2016, before the Muskrat Falls Reservoir was flooded, mercury levels in Inuit people living in and around the Lake Melville area were already 2 to 2.5 times higher than the average Canadian because of the downstream effects of decades of methylmercury buildup from the Churchill Falls Reservoir 300 kilometers upstream. The Make Muskrat Right campaign demanded that the reservoir be cleared prior to flooding to mitigate risks to Indigenous people. In June 2019, the UN Special Rapporteur on Human Rights and Toxic Chemicals visited Canada and condemned its management of toxic hazards, referring to the pending flooding of the reservoir at Muskrat Falls as a blatant disregard for Indigenous rights. Less than a month later, the Dwight Ball government confirmed the province would not undertake any clearing of vegetation from the reservoir to mitigate methylmercury levels prior to flooding. He gave as a reason an unfortunate oversight in scheduling, and then offered to divide up a $30 million fund as compensation to Indigenous communities for exposure to harm. It is a fact that our government chose to flood the reservoir with full knowledge of the risks to the health and welfare of the Indigenous people of Labrador. At every stage, this project has been plagued by delays and cost overruns. It's already 2 years late and over $6 billion over budget, and there are more issues. A serious flaw with the software needed to control the TLI transmission lines built by General Electric, and the synchronous condensers, which are needed to stabilize power, are undergoing massive rework because of issues. The cost of Muskrat Falls is now somewhere over $13 billion. To put that in perspective, our provincial net debt is estimated to be somewhere between $14 and $15 billion, so it has essentially doubled our provincial net debt. When it comes to paying for Muskrat Falls, our government will be making a political decision. I hope they will not choose the path of austerity, which has been shown not to work, and would result in major job losses, service cuts, school and hospital closures, and more. I hope they will be open and honest with the public and pay us the respect that we are due as adults. And I hope the public will pay attention and inform ourselves. These bills are coming due, and we will have to pay. The question is how. For those who say that mega hydro projects are green energy and help fight climate change, like our government, I have to query that sales pitch. Damming rivers and flooding land is not clean. It's not green. It destroys, largely in Canada, Indigenous lands, poisons fish and birds, and displaces communities, and in most cases adds to the climate crisis. Believe it or not, Nalcor is moving ahead with plans to develop Gull Island, another much larger hydro project upstream from Muskrat Falls on the Lower Churchill River. Their environment assessment process has already been done, though there are serious concerns from residents and scientists as to the integrity of that process. It seems insane to continue down this road, does it not?
We were sold a project that would be the next chapter in our province's future, a future that will be guided by independence, security, and self-sufficiency, and that it would stabilize rates for residents and businesses and meet our needs.
Oh, little Kathy, you believed it too. What a load of crap. Our political elite make these major policy decisions without sharing information with the public in a timely and adequate manner. In the case of Muskrat Falls, They didn't have all the information themselves before making multi-billion dollar decisions that have serious long-term implications for the majority of people in the province. Our political system supports that dysfunction, and it needs to change. We need some major democratic reform here if we are to survive, so that we can stop repeating these deeply negative historical patterns. There are a lot of good ideas in the province already for how to go about that. How about we start with reforming campaign finance rules and banning corporate and union donations to political parties, along with those $500 a plate premier's fundraising dinners? How about we have equal representation in our House of Assembly and do a better job of removing the barriers at the riding level that prevent women from becoming candidates? How about we have reserved seating for Indigenous representation in the House of Assembly? How about we encourage higher civic engagement and participation in our youth and in our population in general? How about we raise the bar on quality of discourse in the House of Assembly so that our legislature is a source of pride? If we have a more diverse group of political leaders, we will be better represented, and there will be more ideas at the table for how to move forward through these complicated times. At the end of Muskrat Falls, a misguided project Commission of Inquiry report, the Commission made a bunch of recommendations to government to help ensure that we don't repeat the same mistakes on another project. I really hope Dr. Andrews' government will follow those recommendations. In his conclusion, Judge LeBlanc said, "The reality is, the financial burden brought about by the project has significantly diminished the confidence of many in the province." Yeah, it seriously has. It's a bummer. And it feels overwhelming at times because we don't yet know exactly how it will affect us. So what can we do to make sure it doesn't happen again? Well, one thing most of us can do is to commit to being better informed citizens. And the best way to do that is to support independent journalism in the province. We can donate and subscribe to The Independent, or The Indie. It's awesome, and it's our only independent paper left. We can become a more informed citizenry and join the public discourse. We can say no to building another mega hydro project at Gull Island on the Lower Churchill River in Labrador. I think we can all agree that we live in one of the most beautiful places on Earth. I'm filled with hope every time I look out my window. We have significant challenges to meet to adjust to a changing world. The good news is that all of the talent and expertise we need to address our issues already exists within the province. It's already here. We've also had a lot of experience recovering from economic hardship. I'm willing to pay a small increase in electricity rates and in personal income taxes, as long as I can be assured those funds are being used responsibly. So, what the hell kind of love story is this anyway? It's a complicated one for sure. There has to be room in the tub for all of us, whether we like it or not. And the thing is, not everyone we'll be able to afford hot water once Muskrat Falls comes on stream. Our province needs a therapeutic intervention. We need to be able to acknowledge our dysfunctional behaviors and negative patterns so that we can stop repeating them. I can feel empathy and understanding for everyone involved in bringing Muskrat Falls to fruition, and also anger at the whole body for saddling us with a fucking boondoggle. Those feelings are not mutually exclusive. I can hold them both together in truth at the same time. Before I end tonight, I just want to acknowledge the incredible privilege I have enjoyed as artist in residence in this beautiful facility. I've been well supported by the expertise in this building. I received generous support from ArtsNL, from the Canada Council for the Arts, and from the Arts and Culture Centres. All of these organizations are funded by the government, and they have supported me in the creation of a piece that criticizes the government. That's a remarkable privilege, one that I hope I may enjoy again.